caption, TPE presents The Psychology of Adult Development. Title, Phenomenal Psychology.
It's a long time.
Humour.
I think this is the first time I've joined without having microphone problems.
Oh. On a video call.
Well, hello, Ryan, and welcome to the podcast, everybody. Today we'll be talking about humor.
Ryan and Pablo simper as they get set.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Yep.
What do we want to say about humor? We've attempted and we've talked about recording this before, and we wanted to like have it to be a humorous thing. We wanted to like actually include humor in it. I hope we do.
But We just did. We just had a little blooper there that was funny. So
that's it. From it won't be funny. That was it. That was your funny moment, and now we're gonna get very serious about funny.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm gonna talk about my experience with humor. The way I use it or experience it and feel about it before, and before is like when I was younger, and maybe how I experience it and feel about it today. And you'll do the same thing. That is the structure of our podcast today. How does that sound?
Mm-hmm. Sounds very serious and very structured.
Yes. Okay. So would you like to begin?
Then and now.
So would you like to begin with and tell me a little bit about your experience with humor growing up? How you experienced it and your thoughts about it.
Ryan sits in a living room with a modern decor.
Sure. Wow, I feel like it's just kind of a cold start, like just jumping right in here. So
you don't have to bring attention to the cold start. Just do it. Just warm it up.
Ryan laughs and Pablo smiles.
Well, it's like we had this idea for this podcast and we didn't chat a lot about it. This is kind of the way that we're doing this now, is to have a general idea and then come on in here and see what happens. So this is part of it too, of me feeling a little bit of nervousness of like talking about family stuff, you know? But yeah, it's like for me, I feel like I've always been called a joker my whole life. And that goes back like as long as I can remember. In preparation for the podcast today, I was thinking about it and remembering lots of the goofy stuff I did when I was a kid and the things that I did to make people laugh. And I was trying to go back as far as I could. I was trying to remember like being as young as possible, where I have a really clear memory of doing something for the purpose of making people laugh, to be funny. And I was like going back through all these like memory files and experiences. And I realized that I was the joker of the house, the youngest of the siblings, and I was always making jokes. And I realized when I think back on it that I was doing it because that was the only way I could actually connect with my family members. Like there was a lot of sadness and fear in my house from as far back as I can remember. And I really remember like my relationship with my mother, that the only way I feel like I could actually tolerate being around her with the sadness and the fear that existed in the house was to make her laugh. Making her laugh made me feel like, okay, we're gonna survive. Somehow we're gonna be okay. And so I would just become this absolute clown to make her laugh. And when she would laugh at me being a goofball, like I felt safe when she was laughing. Like, and so that became like my mechanism of surviving in my house. And it just became a thing, and it just followed me. Like I was always, I learned very young that was the way to connect with people. It's like, if you can make them laugh, then it can feel safe. It can be safe. And,
he reflects.
And when I'm thinking about that now, it feels really different from the experience of being known as such a hilarious person and being so funny, but realizing that there was a lot of pain connected to that as well, that the only way that I could feel like I was somebody in the household, that I was visible in the house, was if I was being silly or funny or self-deprecating humor, drawing attention to myself, being ridiculous.
Pablo nods and Ryan takes a deep breath.
Did that extend, Did things change when you were outside the home, like when you got into school and classmates and stuff?
You know, I think it was the same thing for me, but it had a different impact. And I was doing the same kinds of things. Like in my home, I was either like invisible or gone, or I was being funny and goofy and silly. And that was also how I was outside of the house as well. In school with like kids in the neighborhood that I knew, it's like I was either a loner and off doing my own thing, or I was making people laugh. And I when I think about my experience in school, and particularly like in the classroom with teachers, I know that I used humor as a way to keep my teachers from being more curious about who I was and what was possibly going on in my house. That as long as I was like full of humor and making people laugh, that protected my house from being looked at closer of what was going on in there. I didn't have that awareness at that time. I have that awareness now when I'm thinking about it, of how much I was using humor as a wall to keep people away and getting closer to me by being this performer.
And to give them the impression that maybe everything's okay. Don't worry about me. Don't look over here.
Yeah, it's like, oh, he's a happy kid. Like he's got a good life. Like looks like everything's okay. I mean, who knows? Who knows what they saw or felt or even noticed this? Like, they may not have noticed much at all, but I certainly did have a very keen sense at a very young age to protect my house from curiosity that could result in something really bad happening to either my mother or my sisters and I, being taken out of the house or something. So humor was like a tool that I used to either like make myself invisible or try and like give my family some relief from the pain and shit that was going on in the house.
Pablo nods while Ryan ponders.
Which is so bizarre, like thinking about that now. Because at the time I just thought I was like a hilarious kid. Like I knew so many jokes. Like I had joke books. Like I would like read through my joke books and like memorize jokes and be telling them constantly. And when I remember those experiences of like reading jokes, like it was a pleasurable experience. But when I think about how I was actually communicating those jokes to family members, when I see those snapshots in my head, it's like I have a lot of images of like really sad, scared people around me that I was looking to rescue out of that pain and be here with me, like have fun with me. I also need to be noticed in the house as well, because I was also terrified. I was using humor as a means of survival as well, that if people were laughing, then it couldn't possibly be as scary as it was in the house if you're laughing.
You're putting up a wall for yourself to make everything okay, smooth the edges off of some things. A lot of responsibility on a kid, you know?
Ryan nods.
Yeah, and my, like, it really helped and hurt me with friendships and relationships with other kids too. Like I moved around a lot, so there wasn't a lot of staying one place for a long period of time. So that was also a means of like connecting with people. It's like, if I could arrive into a new class partway through the year where I'm the new kid, and like, that's, nobody actually wants to have that experience, to be the new kid and trying to find your way when everyone else has already like made friends and the cliques are there and they know what the heck they're doing. And I'm arriving with all of that stuff in the house following me into the room, and then just being the class clown to find like I had a place. Like, you don't have to worry about me. I'm a clown. I know what I'm doing. Like, you can just leave me be unless I'm making you laugh. So it was very isolating. I felt really alone a lot of the time. I was either on as the Joker or I was like gone. I was on or gone. Yeah.
Pablo stares pensively and offers a gentle nod.
Wow. There's so many things to say about that, and like so many different directions to go in with this conversation right now, but where do you want to go with it?
Ryan
considers.
I I think it's really good. Like we're here doing a podcast about humor. And it's like, this is heavy stuff. Like this is really personal stuff too that I'm sharing about myself. And I can also like take a moment to just realize like how funny I am and how funny I was too. Like in all that pain and in all of that scary moments and fear and sadness and stuff too, it's like I also learned a lot of the mechanics of humor and it worked really well for me. Like it wasn't bullshit. I wasn't like a bullshit funny guy. Like I really could like read, I got a very early lesson on how to read the room, which was part survival, but now it's not survival. Now it's knowing. It's like, I'm really keen on picking up on feelings and emotions of people around me, and that humor can now be something that makes me more visible and makes me more connected and people feel connected to me. It's actually me like asking for people to notice me and be with me as opposed to that wall. Like there's a huge difference here and we can talk about that more, but I'm more than happy to like feel that right now and sit back and ask you about little Gonzalez, little Pablo.
They never called me that. Yeah.
Both men chuckle.
Of course they didn't.
Maybe a little. Little Mr. Gonzalez, what they called me.
Little Mr. Gonzalez.
Little Professor Gonzalez. That's what my parents called
me. Ryan mimics stroking a beard.
Yes, always stroking your beard, wondering.
Yeah, just investigating the mysteries of life. Very serious child. Yeah. So I think I can relate to some of what you were saying about the use of humor in my home as like a tension breaker and a way to connect and smooth things over a little bit and make things okay and make unhappy people in the house lighten up for a moment. And it is good training for the world in a way. I wish there was easier ways to get there. I'm sure there were easier ways to get there, but it is good training of how to read a room and how to defend yourself in difficult situations. And so as a child, it was definitely like a shield to protect myself from unhappy feelings and situations. But I had some great mentors like Ernie from Sesame Street, a great early comedy mentor of mine. I just found him so funny as a kid.
He taught you some good stuff when you were a kid?
They smirk.
Taught me some really good stuff. And then when I meet Berts in the world, you know, I know how to deal with them.
Yep.
Ryan, you and I have talked about our Ernie Bert style of relationship.
Yeah. Yes. I'm happy to be your Bert. I'm happy to be your Bert.
I'm thrilled to have a Bert. It's so good to have a Bert.
Stuff's got to get done.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. And somebody's got to be in the corner giggling.
That's, right? See, you're being an amazing Ernie right now. You're making me laugh, and you're bringing me out of the stickiness of what I was just talking about. So I'm here.
And so I want to talk about that down the road about its uses. But later on, as a teen, I really did use it as a weapon, sometimes as a shield and often as a weapon. And I'm not very proud of some of the ways in which I used humor to make myself feel more important by making others feel less important, being cruel, being mean. And when you're good at using humor, you can use it to really hurt people and like undermine people and make yourself feel special while making others feel less special. It can be very toxic, actually.
And you're aware of it?
And then as I got
that way?
At the time, I was just so proud of myself for how clever I was at being able to put people in their place. And I really didn't think that I was putting them in their place. It was just a really like combative mentality, which if some people were on board for that, I had some really good and tight, close-knit friends, and they found me clever as well. And if you were on the outside of that, it wasn't very nice to deal with me or to have to talk to me. And on some level, that it was still using humor as a defense and a deflection away from me. I did not want to or was not available to be myself in front of people. So I was just going to be this cutting jerk, this like really tough talking little jerk. And as I got older, it's continued to do a disservice to me, being so humorous or trying to be humorous all the time, in that I had a difficult time in intimate relationships with people. So I'm not just talking about partners and lovers and stuff like that, but just like getting deeper with friends. And yeah. there was a barrier there because I would have to turn everything into something humorous because I think I was uncomfortable being real. And then with romantic partners, really just undermining deep connections and ruining moments and always keeping a safe distance away from people so I didn't have to be so vulnerable. And I was doing that with even more awareness in the moment, even something that I would talk about with girlfriends and stuff, like, hey, when you made that joke, you know, we were having kind of a nice moment there and you ruined it. And I'm like, yeah, I know, I'm sorry, but not having any handle on still feeling so uncomfortable that I would do it again.
Ryan nods.
But then as I started to develop a better relationship with myself and started to actually like myself and not just liking those parts of me that were great at defending myself and stuff like that, like embracing my insecurities a little bit and even having love and compassion for myself, then I think humor became much more of a tool to reach people and create intimacy and create closeness. I'm sure I still do use it, and you could probably tell me better than I can about if I do use it to sometimes push people away if I'm not feeling very centered. I'm sure I do that still, but I do with a little more awareness and I do with a lot more care to like not completely push people away, because it's not my intention anymore is to be alone. My intention is now to have a life full of relationships and intimacy and love from friends and family. So anyway, yeah, from shield to sword, now it's more of a tool. It has nothing to do with combat. It has more to do with connection.
Or if it does have something to do with combat, still sometimes of worry about conflict or avoiding conflict, or even, I'm speaking for myself too,
yeah,
of even creating conflict to try and break that discomfort in the moment. It sometimes can feel easier to create conflict with humor than say, I'm uncomfortable with you right now and I don't know what to do about it. To use some of those things that we know so well. And I think also like that, yes, that still happens. Like in our relationship, as we continue to know more about each other, it's like our relationship started in a humorous way that we've even talked about. At the time, it wasn't humorous, but as we like very quickly like reflected on it within weeks or months of knowing each other and talking about that story, it's now become like a very hilarious story for us because we know so much more now than we did then. And we can laugh at ourselves and the things that we were saying and doing. But even still now using it as a bit of a sword, as a tool, I think for you, that if you use that I definitely notice that you have an awareness when you're doing it too, that you're not doing it and you're out the door, that you might do it and pick up on that it might be having an impact that you weren't intending to, and that you do have an awareness to it. And there's still that discomfort of like talking about it a little bit when that might happen, but certainly not
complete avoidance or something like that.
Yeah, like I don't feel from you that you use it as a means of hurting anybody else. I mean, I think we're still working on ourselves with self-deprecating humor and how that works against us sometimes. I mean, I think my whole history of humor was a lot of self-deprecation. And so now when I do it, I really try and do it with more of an awareness and that if it's self-deprecating, I really try and kind of massage it a little bit more to be like, this thing is happening for me right now. And if I can bring attention to it and not feel so much embarrassment or shame, and that I can let people know, it's like, look at me, I'm messing up. I'm being a total goofball right now. I'm not following the rules. And that can be self-deprecating in a way that I'm like actively seeking attention on the mistake that I'm making in order to give myself support and to support others in that connection to be like, yes, we can do this thing, rather than be saying, I'm garbage. You should laugh at me and I'll just grab my things and be going now.
Yeah. You know? Lower your expectations because
yeah,
I'm an idiot. So don't even pay me any mind. Yeah. I think that's, I think I'm glad that you brought up self-deprecating humor, because this is something too that I employ often when I'm uncomfortable or whatever. But I want to be these days much more intentional about it, because it has undercut me, and I've put stuff out there about myself to people in conversation that, you know, is meant to be funny, but it does undercut me. And if you keep putting out the same idea about yourself, that like you are a goofball and that's all you are, or that you're unworthy of being in a room, or that your voice or ideas don't matter, people will treat you that way. That it's what I'm finding. And you give them license to then think of you as less, because if that's the only way that you talk about yourself in deprecating ways, how can they see you any other way? So I'm more mindful of that, and I don't do it all the time anymore. And I definitely don't do it with everybody, because there's some people who are just waiting for the evidence that you're not worthy. And so don't give them the evidence that you're unworthy. And that's what I've come to the conclusion of, like, with you and in my family, like, I feel safe now to like use self-deprecating humor, because I know that you know me. We've developed a relationship that is bigger than any one conversation. So if I'm self-deprecating with you, you can just, that's just Pablo being, he is being silly.
Yeah, I know that about
in
you.
In this moment.
I still love you, even though you're garbage.
Right. Yeah, we can joke about that. But other people will actually seriously think, guy, has no self-esteem. He doesn't like himself. And there's good, and there's probably good reason behind that. And so I'm going to dismiss him too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. And to also mention the fact too, like, because we know each other and because we trust each other and have a relationship as well, that people viewing us or taking us in these moments that they may not know this about us. They might pick up on the banter, that they get a feeling like, oh, these guys have known each other for a while and they can like joke around. Other folks could see this and think like, they're kind of being hurtful towards each other. Like, why are they doing those zingers? And like, you and I have spent like a lot of time like talking about our relationship, talking about humor, talking about how it works and doesn't work for us, the ways that we've been hurt by it, the ways that we feel connected by it. So I feel like that's really important as well, that like, it's not just that we use humor to strengthen our relationship, it's that we actively talk about humor in our relationship and how we can continue to learn from each other and learn about ourselves, so that we're using humor in more and more of a loving way and less of an isolating way. Like for me, like before in my life, I took great pride in knowing that I was I had wit. I was a witty guy. And now when I think about that, about what wit is, it's actually like losing a lot of people by using wit. It's like having this like inside story about something that can really remove connection from a lot of people. So I'm not really interested in being witty so much now. It's more, I really see the beauty in bringing humor into these moments. I can feel very incredibly tender, incredibly vulnerable, where I feel like I'm in a moment, I could just like need to leave. Or feel you ready to leave, and to be able to find a moment to just bring a bit of light into it by making a joke of the absurdity of like, can you believe this is what's going on for us right now? That can just give a pause and feel the humanity in us for a moment. And
Ryan stares pensively as Pablo nods.
To be able to laugh together in the pain is a beautiful thing. It's a really beautiful thing.
That kind of brings us to one of an idea that like of like gallows humor, or that humor that people employ under really tough circumstances. And I think in our lives, contextually within our lives, we've had difficult experiences. And if we've used humor to get through those circumstances where otherwise it might have had a much harder impact in those moments, life in general. I don't know if I'm making any sense right now, but
keep going.
Can you talk a little bit about the way you've used in your work or in your life that type of humor?
You and I and other people that we work with and other relationships outside of this where we have a kind of connection to the kind of work, or not even the work. Like, I think it really is about the stuff that we've experienced in our lives. when we've taken those moments and taken a chance and been vulnerable and shared something about ourselves that was a risk, was taking a step, you know. And I have felt so wonderfully supported to share something where I feel like this is a part of me. Like I am offering a part of me to you that is not something that I'm used to. This feels very new. This feels very scary. And to be able to share something and it be felt, and then also to receive humor in it as well, that isn't making fun of, that isn't minimizing or escaping what I'm saying. It's the times that we've been able to like talk about these things and find the humorous connections.
Ryan shifts his gaze and considers.
Has made it so much more comfortable to share more. It's like if we can talk about our shit, if we can talk about our shit and hear it and then still like laugh about it as well and keep the humor going and continue to share, it's like that feels like a really good flow for me. It's like I can feel deep, I can feel shaky, and I can feel the emotions, and I can have tears in my eyes and feel so afraid, and then to be able to just like burst into laughter moments later just gives my body so much support to like, okay, that didn't destroy me, that was okay, we're still together, and I can share a little bit more, getting that relief from humor. And with gallows humor too, it's like it's a certain kind of humor where we're talking about stuff that we understand in our lives. We're joking about something that we understand. We're not joking about something that there's a misunderstanding. It's that we share a common experience or a feeling about something, and we can bring a joke about that feeling that connects us, that a lot of other people wouldn't get, for sure. It's a specific context. It's about something private and personal, perhaps, that some people might get, but it's really something that's specific to the dynamic and the content of what we're sharing. That could really make people cringe. Like, how could you possibly make a joke about that thing? I'm sure everybody's got stories like that. Like, how could you find that funny in that moment?
Right. Yeah, I mean, you're talking about like personal events, and then there's like world events, and some people will automatically make a joke of like a really devastating and tragic world event. And I think it's an innocent navigation of a difficult idea that, like, if it's too much for me to engage in it on a serious level in this moment, maybe making a joke of it helps me absorb it in a safe way where then I am then able down the road to talk about it in a more holistic and serious manner. I think that's true for me when it comes to like when I hear some horrible news, like my mind does go to absurd places. And I think that's just a way in.
Ryan offers a gentle nod.
So I don't think it's either good or bad, I guess, is what I'm saying. I think it's just a way in.
Yeah. And to be able to, for us to be able to find humor in the obscure, I think is, to find the obscurity and to be able to laugh about it is so helpful. Of not feeling like I'm sharing something with you and I'm so alone in sharing this with you and I'm still alone sharing this with you, that if we can find something so ridiculously obscure, it's like, I feel like you get it.
Ryan clutches his chest.
It's how can you not feel like someone gets it if you can make this obscure joke that makes you laugh about it, that isn't a fake laugh or I'm laughing with you. It's like, laughing with you, but not really feeling it. Like the kind of humor that I'm talking about is when we're truly feeling the humor in the moment and to feel the ridiculousness of it. And that I feel connected to the world. If one person can laugh at something with me, I'm like, I'm sure there's others, but in this moment, it's like, I'm not alone with this difficult, painful experience. We can actually like, look at it from different angles and kind of poke it and have some jokes, and it can take some of the pressure and power out of it. It can really take some power out of it and give me some power back as well, to know that I can find ways to laugh about it and still know that it's a story that matters.
Hmm. Yeah, that by laughing about it, you're not dismissing it. You're not ignoring it. It's a way of engaging in it.
Yeah, I remember a student in another class talking about this and how much it resonated with me, talking about like being the not finding themselves to be a really funny person, but it was a way that they felt like they could share stuff with friends that they wouldn't be able to do otherwise. And, like new friends, new people in their life that they wanted to actually build some trust with and have intimacy with, but there were challenges there about, I mean, I don't even know, but it doesn't matter what those pieces are, but the student was sharing how that to be able to sit in front of the TV and be watching a show and like make a joke about something is letting people in. It's letting people in and sharing a joke that opens a door to talk about it more in a way that you can kind of like hit the gas or hit the brake and decide the pace at which you want to share and build that intimacy with somebody, rather than saying, hey, like, I really want to connect with you, but here's all this shit that I want to share. Like, are you up for that? Like, that's a hard thing to introduce or even be receptive to. It's a scary thing. So doing it through jokes also like opens little doors. Like, I'm willing to talk about this, but just in this way right now, but it's still building something between us.
Mm. I think about even in the, okay, so that's on an individual level, it works. And I think in terms of like solidarity for movements, it works. And I think there are historical instances where, humor is like a building block for so many social connections. Of true solidarity and camaraderie that people create with one another when they can share. Because you have to have a certain shared perspective or understanding in order for everybody to get a joke. You have to have some basis of understanding with one another for you to find something humorous and for me to find the same thing humorous for the same reason. Mm-hmm. So it can kind of like be a like a meter or a like a like what do I want to say here like
Ryan shrugs
to take the temperature of a relationship.
I don't know, Ernie. If you're, what are you trying to say? Up.
They giggle.
I don't know what I'm trying to say. I think you could use it to measure. You can use it as a measurement of, are we aligned here, humor, right? Because if you don't find something funny and it hits you the wrong way, there's something misaligned between us that needs to be examined or explored. And it also builds and creates that connection.
I'm going to use a BERT word, a barometer.
That was the word I was looking for, BERT. Wish you had come in with it earlier.
I'm feeding my pigeons.
Yes, and doing the pigeon. Yeah.
What,
so
a good,
I think it's,
good, what
yeah,
a good note for us to almost end on.
Let's just end it right now. Perfect. We nailed it.
Ryan laughs hysterically.
Have we said it all about humor? Have we said many things?
Yeah, it's like we've talked about like how we felt it and understood it. Those years ago and the things that have changed in us and how what we're looking for that's different now, what we believe we're worthy of and wanting to continue to work towards. And also it's like, I think the final thing that we wanted to just touch on, and maybe we've already done this, is just like why humor matters to us right now as well. Like as teachers mm-hmm. in the classroom, teaching in a college during a pandemic, everything that's going on in the world, it's like we were surrounded and engulfed in a lot of pain in the world. And if there are ways that we can introduce humor into it to connect with each other and to laugh and to get some support and to get a break from some of that pain too, I'm all for it. I'm not afraid to keep finding ways to bring laughter and play into our work, because it also means a lot to me too. Like I love to laugh and connect with people with humor. So I'm really happy that we brought this as a component of the class, and looking forward to us finding more ways that we can laugh and bring goofiness into the class without taking away from the weight and the importance of the content in people's stories. It's not to minimize, it's to bring more perspective and feelings into the experience, you know.
As teachers in this course and over the past few semesters that we've been teaching it, there's been so many moments of rich gifts that we've received from students. And those are those moments when people feel safe enough with us and in the context of a classroom and their classmates to share something about themselves that is true and that then resonates with somebody else, and then and somebody else will then have the freedom to speak about that thing. So there's so many ways to do that. You could be deadly earnest about something, and that's a great way to share. And then other people have used humor, and so just to see the way that people use these ways of communicating with one another, that is so lovely and lands differently with different people. It just makes it so rich. And I've had so many laughs in class. I hope we continue to have many laughs in class, and so many serious moments in class. And it's like a reflection of the richness of life. And that's one of the gifts that we have teaching this course, is to be able to experience the richness of life, all these different experiences being told in so many different ways. And some of our students are really good at using humor to reach us and to reach each other.
Also the gift that we bring as teachers as well, that we, humor plays a big part in our role in our lives. And we also want to have all of us in the class as well as teachers. Mm-hmm. That we are bringing as much of ourselves as we can, that we want to and feel that matters. So to try and teach a course like this without being ourselves and trying to remove the humor to be like a serious person and to cover all this content, like that doesn't feel right for me. So also like having humor like means that I'm allowed in this space. I'm allowed to be me, and students are allowed to be themselves as well. And this is what like, needs to work for us too, right?
Mm-hmm. No, that's a great point. If we were to cut off, if we said, okay, no humor in this class, we'd be just chopping off a huge piece of ourselves to be able to stick with the class. And we don't want that for anybody, right? Like that what we're trying to do is come in our entirety. And that's like, you know, hard feelings and funny feelings and sad feelings and all of it. Mm-hmm. That's what we're trying to encourage people to bring to the classroom too. And we can only do that if we are bringing our full selves. We can't expect people to bring their full selves if we're going to hide who we are.
Yeah. Yeah. That's it, Ernie. We're done.
That's it. That was, I just nailed it at the end there. I'm really thrilled with myself.
Yeah. You're growing up.
Ernie. Happy about you. I'm thrilled with myself.
Yeah.
Pablo smirks.
Okay.
I guess that means
good to see you.
Let's go to the windowsill now and check on the doodle bugs.
I don't even remember that. I'm gonna have to go look that up. They had doodle bugs?
Man. That's sad. All the humor is gone now. We're ending this on very sad now. Come on, Ernie.
Ryan smiles.
I'm sorry.
All right, that's the end of our podcast. We're done.
All right. See you around.
Bye. Bye.
Title: Phenomenal Psychology. Caption: thank you for watching. Fade to black.